Oh, give me land, lots of land, under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide open country that I love. Don't fence me in.
Do you think there's any good reason for one country to take control of another country? If so, under what circumstances do you think that would be justified? In this section, you'll learn about the new imperialism of the late 19th century. During this time, European nations began to acquire colonies in Asia and Africa in order to obtain raw materials and markets for their manufactured goods. The new imperialism. In the 19th century, a new phase of Western expansion into Asia and Africa began. Beginning in the 1880s, European nations began to compete for overseas territory. Imperialism, or the extension of a nation's power over other lands, was not new. But the new imperialism of the late 19th century was different. Previously, European expansion in Africa and Asia had been limited to setting up a few trading posts. Now European nations wanted direct control over vast territories. Europeans had various motives for imperialism. There was a strong economic motive. Europeans were looking for raw materials such as rubber, oil, and tin for their industries. They were also looking for new markets for their manufactured goods. They wanted more direct control over the areas within the raw materials and markets. There were also political motives. European nations were rivals. They tried to acquire colonies in order to gain an advantage over their rivals. Some people believed that a nation could not be great without colonies. Imperialism was also tied to social Darwinism and racism. Racism is the belief that race determines traits and capabilities. Racists believe that particular races are superior or inferior to others. Finally, some Europeans had religious and humanitarian motives. They believed that Europeans had a moral responsibility to civilize primitive people. They called this responsibility the white man's burden. These people believed that Western nations should help the nations of Asia and Africa. To some, this meant bringing the Christian message to these nations. To others, it meant bringing the benefits of Western capitalism and democracy to these countries. Colonial takeover in Southeast Asia. By 1900, nearly all of Southeast Asia was under Western rule. In 1819, Britain founded a new British colony on the small island at the tip of the Malay Peninsula called Singapore. Singapore soon became a major stopping point for steamships going to or from China. The next country to fall to the British was the Kingdom of Burma. Britain wanted to control Burma in order to protect its possessions in India. It also wanted a land route through Burma into South China. The French watched nervously as the British moved into Burma. France had missionaries in Vietnam. To keep the British from moving into Vietnam, the French government decided to force the Vietnamese to accept French protection. The Vietnamese ruler gave up territories in the Mekong River Delta. The French also occupied the city of Saigon. During the next 30 years, the French extended their control over the rest of the country. In 1884, France seized the city of Hanoi and made the Vietnamese Empire a French protectorate, or political unit that depends on another government for its protection. In the 1880s, France also extended its protection over Cambodia, Annam, Tonkin, and Laos. By 1900, France included all of its new possessions in a new union of French Indochina. After the French conquest of Indochina, Thailand was the only remaining free state in Southeast Asia. Two remarkable rulers, King Mongkut and his son, King Chulalongkorn, were able to prevent the French and British from placing Thailand under colonial rule. Both kings promoted Western learning and had friendly relations with major European powers. In 1896, Britain and France agreed to maintain Thailand as an independent buffer state between their possessions in Southeast Asia. One more conquest took place in Southeast Asia at the end of the 19th century. In 1898, during the Spanish-American War, United States naval forces under Commodore George Dewey defeated the Spanish fleet in Manila, in the Philippines. President William McKinley decided to turn the Philippines into an American colony. The Philippine Islands gave the United States a convenient jumping-off point for trade with China. Many Americans, including President McKinley, also believed that Western nations had a moral obligation to, quote-unquote, civilize other parts of the world. The Filipinos did not agree. Emilio Aguinaldo was the leader of a movement for independence in the Philippines. His guerrilla forces fought against U.S. troops to gain their independence, but they were defeated. Colonial regimes in Southeast Asia. Western powers ruled their new colonial empires either by direct or indirect rule. Sometimes a colonial power could establish its goals through cooperation with local rulers or political elites. In these cases, indirect rule was used. Local rulers were allowed to maintain their positions of authority and status. Indirect rule made it easier to gain access to an area's natural resources. It also lowered the cost of government because fewer officials had to be trained. Indirect rule also had less impact on local culture. One example of indirect rule was in the Dutch East Indies. Officials of the Dutch East India Company allowed a local land aristocrat in Dutch East Indias to control local government. These local elites maintained law and order and collected taxes. Indirect rule was not always possible, however. This was especially true when local rulers resisted colonial rule. In these cases, the local rulers were removed from power and replaced with a new set of officials brought from the mother country. This system is called direct rule. In Burma, for example, the monarchy opposed the colonial rule. As a result, Great Britain abolished the monarchy and ruled the country directly through its colonial government in India. In Indochina, France used both direct and indirect rule. It used direct rule in the southern provinces in the Mekong Delta, but in the northern parts of Vietnam were governed as a protectorate. The emperor still ruled but had little power. France had a similar policy in Cambodia and Laos. Local rulers were left in charge with French advisors to counsel them. To justify their conquest, Western nations had said they wanted to bring the blessings of Western civilization to the colonies. Many colonial powers said they wanted to teach the native peoples about the democratic process. However, many Westerners became afraid of giving Native peoples political rights. They were afraid that the Native peoples would want full participation in the government or even independence. The colonial powers did not want their colonies to develop their own industries. Colonial policies stretched the export of raw materials. In many cases, this policy led to some form of plantation agriculture, in which peasants worked as wage laborers on plantations owned by foreigners. Plantation owners kept the wages at poverty levels in order to increase the owner's profits. Conditions on plantations were often so unhealthy that thousands died. Taxes were also a burden for peasants. But colonial rule did bring some benefits to Southeast Asia. Colonial governments built railways and highways. In some countries, small growers of rubber, palm oil, coffee, tea, and spices were able to benefit from the development of an export market. Resistance to colonial rule. Many people in Southeast Asia were very unhappy with being ruled by Western powers. At first, resistance came from the ruling classes. In Burma, for example, the monarch himself fought against British rule. Sometimes resistance to Western rule took the form of peasant revolts. Many peasants were driven off the land to make way for plantations. This led to peasant uprisings. Early resistance movements failed, but a new kind of resistance began to emerge at the beginning of the 20th century. This resistance was based on nationalism. The leaders were often part of a new class that had been created by colonial rule, westernized intellectuals in the cities. This new class had been educated in Western-style schools. They were the first generations of Asians to understand the institutions and values of the West. Many spoke Western languages. At first, many of the leaders of these movements did not focus on the idea of nationhood. They simply tried to defend the economic interests or religious beliefs of the natives. In Burma, for example, students at the University of Rangoon formed an organization to protest British lack of respect for local religious traditions. Not until the 1930s did these resistant movements begin to demand national independence.
Don't you fence me in.